Hello, and welcome to the Brooklyn Rail's 629th New Social Environment. I'm Chloe, the Director of Programs here at the Rail, and I have the pleasure and privilege of being your MC today for a conversation featuring Lola Montes Schnabel and Patrick J. Reed. We're thrilled to welcome poet Isa Guzman here to close today's program. Before we get started, the Brooklyn Rail acknowledges that Black Lives Matter. Here in New York, we're on Lenape Hoking, the unceded land and waters of the Wappinger, Canarsie, Munsee, and Lenni Lenape people of the Delaware Nation and Shinnecock Indian Nation. We recognize land acknowledgments are not a replacement for actual, necessarily decolonial work, but a reminder of place, of the legacies of dispossession and enslavement that sustained and enriched the stolen land we are speaking from. And today it's my pleasure to introduce the guest and host. Born in New York, Lola Montes Schnabel is a painter, printmaker, photographer, and filmmaker who is exhibited in Southampton, Los Angeles, Miami, and many other cities internationally. Montes Schnabel graduated with a BFA from the Cooper Union in 2008. She serves on the board of advisors at Anthology Film Archives and lives and works in Sicily. Artist and writer Patrick J. Reed's work explores a range of topics, including the intersection of philosophy, disaster studies, and the ecological dimensions of creative practice. He's the assistant curator at Fulcrum Arts, a nonprofit organization working at the intersection of art and science to impact positive social change on a civic scale. He's a contributor to The Rail as well as other publications. And with that, it's my pleasure to pass it over to you, Patrick.
Thank you so much, Chloe. Thank you for the introduction. And Lola, so nice to be here with you today. Thank you for joining me.
You too. Thank you, Patrick.
So the main topic of our conversation today is an exhibition that you have at Nina Meyer Gallery in Los Angeles at their Glassell Park. Thank you. Location. It opened in the middle of July and it wraps up at the end of this month. Is that correct?
Yes, it is.
The exhibition is titled, and you'll have to help me with the pronunciation, but I think it's Faccio d'Angelo.
Exactly.
Every angel has another face. And if we could see, Chloe, an installation view of that first room to give everyone some context, I think it'd be helpful to just cover the basics about what's in the show. This is your first exhibition in Los Angeles. Is that correct? Your first solo exhibition?
Yes, it's my first solo exhibition. I've been in a few group shows there.
So, and it consisted of a number of different types of work, right? Three-dimensional primarily, even the wall works. There are these table tile works, and then I believe you call them sculptural vessels, candelabras, and a number of ceramic wall pieces. Could you tell me a little bit about how these works came to be? Because they are a bit of a departure, is that correct, from what you were usually working in? Yeah.
Sure. I guess I found this material here in Sicily when I moved here, and I had a history of traveling and working with artisans in different places. So it gave more meaning to my time on this island to work with the material that was native to this place. So I always made clay sculptures as a kid in school, but this was something that came very naturally. And the fact that there's a water-based element when you use the pigments, when you paint with ceramic, they're powders and you have to mix them with water. So basically I like the liquid element of it and then it becoming something solid. And I like to cook too. So having an oven where you fire them and anticipate the kind of birth of this medium is exciting to me, because there's actually a music to the maiolica, to the tile. When you open the oven, there's this sound of tingling, and it's a big experiment. I don't claim to know much about this technique. I taught myself being here in the last year and a half, but it seemed to be a good match with my watercolor and painting style, because I always kind of would add Damar varnish or turpentine to oil paint to make it more liquidy. So this was a way that I could combine sculpture and drawing and painting into one form. So I really see them as like paintings, that even though they're ceramic.
Yeah, it's interesting you mentioned that, that tingling sound that the ceramics make. My partner makes ceramics and he'll bring home very large pieces sometimes and put them in the living room, and then I'll be in there in the evening reading and I can hear them kind of like ping and sort of sing at me. And it's a really unnerving but incredible experience. There's like a spirit to the thing after it comes out.
Exactly. They're alive. And so is the clay. It's like skin. So depending on the temperature of the season, you have to put it out or in the sun and be aware of how dry it is out, because things can crack and you have to wait for the temperature to go down, because if you open it too fast, it can crack. So there's a delicacy to this, even though it's a hard surface, that I like that combination.
Mm-hmm. So just for clarity's sake, you've produced all of this work that's in the exhibition in Sicily.
Yes.
And what is it? Could you tell us what your studio setup is like? You're going to a foundry. Is that foundry in town? Is it on site? What is your context for making these works?
Okay, well, I made a kind of round of Sicily to find out how to do this. So I was in Caltagirone, which has a tradition of making these moorheads, and then Santo Stefano di Camastra, and then also Bagheria, where there was a master named Maurizio Sciana who initiated me into this. This was, he let me paint on the first tiles. And then basically I needed to do this at home because I couldn't be sitting in somebody else's environment. So I bought an oven and I watched how they were glazing the tiles, which is kind of technical. The amount, you know, you need a densimeter and there's a really specific measurement of water and powder. And then I cleaned out. Basically, I live in a farmhouse here surrounded by carob trees. And I'd had many studios in New York, in at Mana Contemporary, and then in a potato barn, and then in the Chelsea Hotel also, or on Mott Street. And I guess I just realized that if I have to spend 12 hours in a room, I'd rather have a bunch of trees around me than cement blocks and people and cars, because a lot of my work comes from my unconscious or from my dreams, and then they become real things. So I need to be able to listen to that. So I got kind of affected by all the noise living in a city.
Yeah.
And realized that I had gone to a lot of museums and seen a lot of shows and had a lot of exposure. But what I needed was just the time and space to be able to go within myself and not be distracted by the outside. So the foundry is a tile making foundry that's been around for three generations, and it's near Catania, near Mount Etna. So there's actually a view of the volcano, and they use clay that then they sprinkle this volcanic ash on top. And I really think that that's very different than buying clay, let's say in Tuscany or somewhere else in the world, because the minerals of that volcanic ash have a kind of vibration that I notice when these particular tiles are cooked. So the big lesson at the beginning was just picking a good tile, because it's like bread. If it's stale or it's been exposed to humidity, or if they mixed pencil shavings or sand inside of it, it doesn't have the same look. And so these have a kind of violet tint within them. When the lights are off, you can see an iridescent glow from within the tile. And that's really where it all started, was just, you know, it's like picking a good watermelon. You've got to flick it and there's a sound. So it's very much intuitive. After a while, you start to feel the right amount of water to use in the colors, or a good tile versus a bad tile.
Yeah, it becomes an intimate understanding of the material that seems itself to have an intimate connection, even memory, to that volcano from which it came, perhaps, right? I think we have, Chloe, don't we have a video of the foundry, but also I wanted to cover a couple other things. So if we could take a quick look at that.
We do have a video of the foundry. I'll share it now. Can everyone see?
Yes, thank you.
at this tile factory called Lupica. It's near Etna and uses volcanic ash lava in tiles. He's letting me make three-dimensional tiles out of shapes and get out of the square. So.
Great, thank you. So those tiles were made, they're the substrates on which you started to paint, and you collected them into a number of grids that then became these table pieces that are within the exhibition. There are three, is that correct? There's what, Amphibian, yes. Undine, and Merkaba. Yeah, can we take a look at Amphibian, please? I think that is going to be slide number.
I've got it here.
Thank you. It's 32.
There we go. Yeah.
And I like this image because I think it's a good introduction into a lot of the themes and the content that is prevalent in your work, Lola. There's the figurative, but the figurative is not, or does not feel that it is necessarily of this earth, right? There's this kind of spectrality to it. And the main figures are composed of these smaller figures that come together in this kind of swirling mass that is legible from a distance as an individual face, for example, but upon closer inspection starts to sort of tease apart, etiolate into these smaller components. Could you, or would you mind sort of describing a little bit about what is happening in this image?
Sure. It's a, well, I've always loved that fairy tale about the frog prince. And I guess this is about metamorphosis. The Book of Ovid has been a big influence, and also Metropolis, the film. So a lot of times I have figures turning into animals or space or things that can happen in the in this world, you know? So in this imaginary world, people can turn into frogs or jump or. So you have this prince on the bottom. I mean, I like also that you could flip it the other way around, and wherever you sit at this table, there is a piece of the story. Mm-hmm. So it works from all dimensions. I mean, from all angles. And this is a kind of color I was trying to see. The thing is when you use green, it looks gray. So I have little color charts, but basically there's some guessing involved, and I was trying to create a certain mood with this color scheme that would feel like water, things dissolving and coming back together into something more solid.
Yeah, it seems that fluidity and water in particular, or suspension in water, is something that is a motif that occurs again and again. In the next slide, I feel like these themes and even these particular details are even more prevalent. And this one is Undine, correct? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Could you explain for us what an Undine is?
Well, I guess it was my kind of deity, or I was trying to create a, I mean, this is about being taken apart or search for identity. If you look really mm-hmm. close to the story, they're kind of children being ripped away from their parents, and this kind of growing pain, you know, of cutting from the umbilical cord. So I guess the story unfolds as I paint it. Mm-hmm. I really just start drawing, and then the whole thing comes out of me. So it depends on the mood that I'm in, but I was really feeling this kind of amputation of body parts. My grandmother was actually a nurse in World War II, and she was the one that would hold the limbs of people being cut. And children. So I feel the pain of that separation, and I just was transmuting it into this particular piece.
Yeah. Is that a common experience for you when you're making work, when you're in the middle of the creative process? There's this kind of, do you feel like you're conducting the emotions of others, or the traces of others' experiences through that process?
Whatever I'm going through in my life definitely comes through, you know. So if I'm living in a city and looking at people that are kind of having a really hard time or suffering or on drugs, that will come out. If I do a portrait of somebody, usually I see things inside of them that they haven't told me through just that intimacy of sitting with them. So this is all, yeah, I suppose there were things that were channeled here that make sense after the fact, you know? It's like a story that then becomes true once you paint it, because there's a level of ritual that manifests something to happen, you know?
Yeah. And, you know, oh, go ahead.
No, no, there's a definitely a Picassoid element in this too. I mean, I couldn't help but revert to my own knowledge of art history, and any artist that's touched this material and taken it to become fine art rather than some kind of hobby with clay. I really wanted to make paintings out of this material and not be stuck in like tchotchkes. I made a few bowls because I needed some for my house, and the candelabra really came out of that necessity. Because I needed some light. But even the bowls, if you look at them, I tried to make them feel like paper, the edges, so they were folded. So even if, you know, playing with this, with movement within something that's still, and then something delicate with something that's hard.
Mm-hmm. And even something organic, if we take a look at the candelabras, they're modeled on artichokes, is that correct?
Yes, they are. I don't know if you've read about this, there's something called the Castra Ura, which is basically in the lagoons near Venice, where they grow these very small artichokes. When you grow artichokes, you have to castrate the first one for others to grow. So it's a type of pruning. So that was a kind of metaphor for me about, you know, it's like when you cut your hair, or here they have these in Sicily, that if you see my ceiling, I don't know if you can see it, it's made out of bamboo reeds and they only cut them on the full moon. So that way they don't rot. But I guess the artichoke for me is a metaphor for love also. You have to get pricked to get to the heart, and then it's not just a flower.
No. Yeah. Something I want to, if you don't mind, circle back to just quickly, because I think it is important here. You've spoken a lot in past interviews and other, you know, in other contexts about the importance of your own personal spiritual path. And I noticed in a lot of this work, there seems to be references to a number of different spiritual traditions. And I'm just curious if you could talk about what that path is for you, and what is your relationship to mythology, to the Abrahamic religions, these various touchstones of our culture.
Okay, sure. I guess when I was a kid, I would often zone off and people would snap their fingers in the air. And when I finally started to meditate, I realized that I had been doing that, but I just didn't know what it was. So it's a kind of conscious way of dreaming. And I began meditating in my 20s to get visions for my paintings, because as many museums you can go to, and I'd always make these pilgrimages to go see my favorite works of art, or save money for a trip to be able to see the Giotto Chapel in Padova, or follow every Caravaggio. I do feel that everything we're ever going to make is inside of us, so it's about unlocking that. So meditation was kind of a key to access this plethora of imagery that was inside of me. And I think that we can learn a lot from being in nature too. You know, I love human beings, and I miss New York for all the crazy characters and the brains there, but it became a bit overwhelming to be able to listen to what was inside of me, to have all of this noise. And so I realized, having been born there and exposed to so much, that I just had to step back for a moment to untangle everything that I had been exposed to. And the more I started to meditate, the noisier it got, to it to because you get more sensitive, you know. So in order to let go my guard of just kind of fighting through New York City, I really had to remove myself to be able to be sweeter and be in touch with the different hours of the day. I mean, during COVID, it was really interesting because there are actual birds and bugs that come out exactly on the dot every day. But I wouldn't have noticed that if I hadn't just edited everything out. And I guess that Christianity has, you know, my father was born Jewish and my mother Protestant, but we were never religious in the house. We had a Christmas tree, but I've always had a little altar in my room with the objects that mean something to me and kind of like to burn things. And painted when I was 7 women with crystal balls and geishas. And a lot of my travels have been to understand different cultures and their rituals, how to consecrate a space or myself or an object so that it has a vibration within it.
You mentioned visions as being an important part of this process. Chloe, could we go to the very last slide, please? So this, I think, is one of the most striking pieces in the exhibition titled Merkaba. And it has stayed with me because of its, because it sparks off thoughts in my brain in multiple registers, you know, and it seems that its points of reference touch on a number of different things. You know, one and perhaps the most obvious is its connection to the vision of Ezekiel in the Bible of seeing God in his chariot, and then, you know, that was rendered again and again and again throughout art history, especially in the Renaissance. I think Raphael has a particularly striking version of it. But the individual symbolism within this table is what really entices me. And because there's the Bible connection, but then also it has all the components of it. Or rather, it has, within it has all the components of that, of the Wheel of Fortune card within the tarot deck. You know, and it seems like it's a very mystical piece, and it functions as a table. So we're seeing it from the top view, but when you experience it in the gallery, it's actually tucked away in a back room and has surrounded by flowers and candles. And it seems that this is a very important piece within the show. Would you agree?
Yes, this is one solid piece of lava, and this is the only piece that I couldn't make at home because I needed a larger oven to fit it in. So I had to go to somebody else's studio, put on headphones, and it was not particularly comfortable because they were playing really loud music and smoking and burping, and the TV was on. So I went really within myself to make this thing. And I was afraid that it was horribly tacky because I am influenced by the environment I'm in. And then I'm happy that people like it because I was very unsure about this piece, honestly. I added another child. Usually there's just a boy on the posts of the chariot. You have a ram's head, an eagle, a lion, and a boy. But I put also a black child there. So that there's this yin and yang, and she's feeding, you know, both races. And the point is, we're all pink on the inside, you know. So I feel that the animals have as much presence as the humans in this.
And the Merkaba is, I'm not as familiar with that tradition. Could you explain it for me?
Well, I guess I really was taking from the passage of Ezekiel in the Bible, but not every prophet is given a vision. Yeah. So this is one of the rare cases. And I think that if you look at Bruegel's Hell landscapes, there's some flying saucers in them. Mm-hmm. And in a way, the chariot is like a UFO as well. So there's a film that I made years ago for Zach Posen, and I used a wheel that was on fire as well there. And this has just been an image that has struck me in other people's work and that I wanted to relate to or make something that had a conversation with that.
And isn't the wheel, like the wheel on fire in particular, it's a type of angelic being, is that correct? I think it's called the Ophanim, or it's the intersecting two wheels. that sits at the right hand of God. And it's oft depicted being on fire. I mentioned it because I'm sort of thinking about what is the role of angels within this exhibition, because it seems like, yes, there is that acknowledgement of the angelic being, but then there's the second part of the title to the exhibition that is Every Angel Has an Ugly Face. And I'm wondering, to what degree is that in reference to this level of spirituality that we're discussing? And to what degree is it commentary on something that is more social of this earth?
Jonas Mikas, who's a good friend of Fong, the founder of the Brooklyn Rail, mm-hmm. and was my good friend, wrote me an email once after having dinner where he was just concerned by all my doubts, and said, you know, I wouldn't trust the art world or anybody, but trust your angels. So he died more than a year ago. And that email means a lot to me, because we have people that make us, and it's important to keep their spirit alive in our hearts, you know? So Rene Ricard, the poet, was really my godfather and named me Lola, and a big influence in my grandmother. And I find that all the painters and poets that have died and ever made anything beautiful are kind of your friends, and everyone that's not born yet. So art history is this beautiful conversation with everyone who's been here and not born yet. I'm getting lost now with your question, but I rambled a little bit. no, the title, Faccio d'Angelo, was actually a bandit in the Veneto area of Italy, and that was his nickname. And, you know, I do feel that when the devil comes to this earth, it disguises itself as a beautiful blonde, you know, blue-eyed person. It's not going to come as a wretched, decrepit old man. And in Los Angeles, when I was there watching, I mean, the moment I rented my car at Hertz, there was a homeless man that walked across the highway wrapped in a white sheet, and his face was so dirty it looked black, and he had these blue striking eyes, and it reminded me of a saint. So I was kind of shocked that in front of Jeffrey Deitch Gallery you had tents with families inside, and that people just closed their eyes to that and pushed them from one neighborhood to the next, you know. And I feel we have some kind of duty to, in the 22nd century, to take care of everybody around us. I mean, there's really no reason why there's no system to support mental health. And I found New York also filled with a lot of people that needed psychological help, and there's just no support system. I mean, that was one reason why I moved to Italy, was I really appreciate the healthcare system here. And I had been bitten by a tick when I was 24 and didn't find out until I was 36. And the whole journey of getting rid of Lyme's disease was very unhelpful to be in America, because they just want to keep you sick. And the fact is, I didn't want to ever say I have this, because then it became part of me. I knew what it was, and it was about getting rid of it. That took going within yourself on a cellular level and changing the way you think, you know, and how you eat, and a lot of other things. But part of my reason for moving here was actually because one of the cures was to treat it like a parasite, and you had to drink unpasteurized goat milk and sheep milk. So Sardinia and Sicily offered that, and I had to do this 3-month milk diet. So it's like becoming a baby again. You just have a bottle of milk, and basically all the parasites come to the surface, and then you kill them with cayenne pepper and wormwood and all this, whatever, cat's claw. That process of cutting off from everything gave me, I made certain paintings within that period that I liked, and I liked working outside and by water. And the fact is, life is very short. So if you spend the whole time in a city and you feel like you want to jump out of a window because it's so noisy, it's better to leave. Then I appreciate it more when I come back.
Chloe, could we go to slide 20, please? This story about the story about the milk and having to consume all of this milk. I mean, it has a mythical quality to it. It sounds like a mythical nurturing story, but it also brings to mind this particular piece called Oracle that was in the exhibition, because there are these two figures, and it looks as though they are made of milk or filled with milk or coated in this, you know, the whiteness of the milk. And it gives them an otherworldly quality, an oracular quality in a way. I also find it interesting that they have this particular, their silhouette has this particular form. They're not a full figure, right? They're sort of like a half or a quarter figure. And it makes me think of the moon as well.
Mm-hmm. Also in the Ascending Souls one, there's that same kind of, I don't know, there's some Paleolithic shapes, like the jade axe or that mm-hmm. that shape on the top. That is a form that comes through sometimes. I also am very influenced by the Ten Commandments. I mean, I love the part where the sea split open, and the one before with the two white figures is as if you saw that floating over a mountaintop, you know, or sometimes uh-huh. you look at clouds and you see these apocalyptic scenes, you know, where the earth looks like it's torn open and there's a castle coming out or some dragon.
Yep. It's interesting to me that you think these are the silhouette of this one, Ascending Souls, is the jade axe. You know, I saw that shape as referencing a vessel, same mm-hmm. with, to a certain extent, Oracle. And there's another one that has that motif again. Anyway, it appears, you know, again and again and again, as well as, you know, physical vessels or literal vessels as well. And, you know, it makes me think of themes of the water bearer and the, you know, pouring of fluids from one container to the next and the alchemical practice involved mm-hmm. or symbolic practice.
Yeah, I think you're spot on. There's a lot of fermentation that goes on here too. People candy, mm-hmm. bitter oranges, and,
yeah.
you know, there's a waterfall here that is three rivers that meet. So I mean, also in India, when I travel there, I'd fill up a water bottle with that water and bring it back. It's called a Triveni in Sanskrit. It's basically where three veins meet. So mm-hmm. I don't know if you're familiar with the Kumbh Mela, but that's a large holy festival that takes place in India for the last 200 years, or maybe more, but it happens every 12 years. And it always happens where three rivers meet. And so I made it a point through my 20s to go to this and collect this water, and I'd have it on my altar, and then there'd be water from Greece, from a certain Coptic church. Or so I guess you're pointing it out, but I wasn't that aware that they all are like vessels. But yes, I feel our bodies are too, you know, and there's something about having bugs live inside of you where you realize that you're like a jar. Something drops in and yeah. you need to get it out.
So you don't often, or rather you're not afraid of, you know, very explicitly talking about apocalyptic themes, rapturous themes, you know, these sort of big and momentous, you know, ideas. But I find in the show that they appear in almost sometimes like sweet sort of ways. There's a piece called Japanese Kiss. I think it's slide 23. It's just a couple on from there. And my initial impression of it is that it was one of these bird's eye views that you were talking about that depict an apocalyptic scene, excuse me, namely a river full of blood. But I also feel like maybe I'm not correct in that reading of it.
I mean, I like to see the way you see it. For me, it was, I very much felt that Fontana, Lucio mm-hmm. Fontana, did something in ceramic that he's known for, that slash. So it was kind of like a love letter to him, this particular okay. one, because I made a ceramic slash. And then the way the flowers were just falling reminded me of the delicacy of Japanese culture. And I have a few Japanese friends that I learn a lot through their silence and their subtlety in which they work. And how gentle they are, really, with their understanding of everything without having to say anything explicitly. But maybe it looks very red in the photo. It's actually an orange that is, yeah. You know, like the street sign orange. It's a, uh-huh. I don't know how you would say that, but that shade of orange, you know, it's like the Tom Sachs orange.
The Fontana connection is interesting because those ceramics, you know, they're the ones with the slashes, like the spheres that have this kind of like gash in them. But then there's the pieces where he, like, it's almost like he took a, not a screwdriver, but some sort of a stylus, let's say, you know, and stabbed it over and created these pockmarks and these holes. And they're very, they elicit a visceral response, right? You know, and that of the feeling of a body, right? And a body being pierced, you know, and therefore bleeding.
Or a big pillow that's imploded. I mean, I'm not sure how you didn't get those pieces to crack. They're kind of miracles. Because they're so big and then they've got all these holes in them. It's as if he played the piano on them too. I remember seeing that piece when I was 16 at the Guggenheim uptown in New York, and really wondering, what is that material? And I've had friends who have made ceramics for years and never went into their studios, and they'd be making clay and just obsessed with it. So this really came naturally. Painting on tiles here, it just became one table, and then I got addicted to it because it was really exciting to wait and see the result come out. That 3-day break or 2-day break where it has to cook and you're not sure what you made, I like that anticipation and being unsure and the experimental aspect of this.
There's another piece in the show called Spell, and it's maybe one of the most complex in terms of its content and its combination of elements. Slide 19, I think, is the one that we're looking for. And I see in that as well, these kind of these slashes and these, this line that is also, that cuts into the surface. I'm especially interested though in the figures and the iconography that you use, because it seems a little more specific, and a little more, private to yourself than some of the other pieces. There's one figure in particular that has a head where there's this kind of red ectoplasm rising out of it, and another sort of spectral form departing from its, I guess, left side.
This is like bone. They're kind of like bones to me. I mean, this was in so many pieces. And only when it went up on the wall in the show did I get to see it all together after all this work. So it was kind of exciting to me to finally see it up, because it was a lot of instinctual, like, cutting and kind of making blobs that then the drawing appeared to me. Because when I'm working with the raw material, it's not very controllable. It's not like clay where you can modulate and shape it. It's more like cement. You can imagine that. So it's very much globby. And I just tried to make direct movements with the clay. And then afterwards they showed me, you know, I saw these chickens or this guy standing there in a little coat. And I don't know if you're familiar with My Little Pony, but there's a moment in the cartoon where these witches that make this purple goop, and they take a sailor's toe and a goldfish, and basically I guess this was like a bunch of ingredients to cast some kind of a spell, and that cartoon made an impact on me as a kid. As well as a lot of different Disney films, like the Sleeping Beauty, you know, when she sees the green light and then pricks her finger. The painting Sylph that's in the show, I think has this Disney quality to it too. It's kind of like the crows at the end of Dumbo, you know, that are singing.
It's been a while, but yes, yeah.
These things really mark you, so you've got to be careful what cartoons you watch. I mean, I didn't realize how deep those images were inside of me. And then just leaving a lot of white here too. This particular one, it's impossible to photograph, because in real life it looks violet and iridescent like seashells. The white part has this reflection of kind of rainbows inside of it.
Do you feel like a person has, or a person can individually influence the course of events within the universe? I ask this because of the title of the piece.
Yes, I do. Look at all these different prophets. I mean, this whole situation that's going on right now in Palestine and Israel, it's all about religion. And now that he is practicing peace, I also think that Hitler had a huge impact on the world. I mean, what they're doing to Palestinians is really, it's almost like some cellular memory where when you die in some god-awful way, you get born with this memory to kind of do it to another person or something. I hope
the notion
that
of the
people
wheel.
I hope that they're, you know, we all think that our child, or if we make a child, it will come and save the world or be that special. I'm not so sure how, if it maybe it comes from suffering, the empathy or kind of being able to feel others' pain and not be so self-centered and want to help. But we're definitely living in a world of extreme narcissism and arrogance. So I hope that art can change that or kind of give you an exit out of this reality. I'm not claiming to do it as one person, but there's certainly people that have given me help. You mentioned Raphael before, and every time I see his hand, it's just masterful. And it doesn't matter if it's from, you know, from the past, he still remains to be on a barometer of truth or a high level that is not, you know, frequently matched.
Yeah. The, you know, I mentioned the individual, but there also seems to be a call for the collective, for gathering, you know, in this exhibition or through the format of this exhibition, which, you know, if one first enters the room, right, it looks like preparations for a feast, right, happening. And I imagine that that feeling is emphasized all the more when the candles are all lit, when the light has softened a little bit at the end of the day, and it actually takes on the quality of the sanctuary, especially this last room, where we can see a number of these sort of egg-shaped, I guess, what do you call them, vessels? How would you describe them?
Well, they're projections. They're kind of angel eggs, right? They look like eggs. Mm-hmm. But they were meant to project the shapes that are cut out. So it wouldn't work that well with a square. And it does work better in a dome-shaped room, or if they're in a corner in pitch black, then you see kind of these angels dancing around the room. And on the top of them, there's a dove-shaped cutout, so it looks like the Holy Ghost is on the ceiling. Mm-hmm. And I wanted to play with light.
What this really evokes for me are the spaces of sort of home churches from like the era of like the earliest era of Christianity, or from, you know, we mentioned Israel, Palestine earlier. There's the site of Duro Europos that was in Syria, where there is the home synagogue in particular that was very elaborately decorated with frescoes. And it has this kind of the same golden glow when I see images of it as what seems to be appearing here. Do you feel like there's a connection to these kind of intimate spiritual enclaves?
Well, I think there's a reason people pray and speak to God, and there's something to acknowledge, you know, what we can't see. So this is just giving a kind of vehicle for something to come through. When my grandmother died, I was in the room and there was a candle that had no wax that burned for 2 weeks. And she has one of those mirrors where you can, you know, really see up close to every pore in your skin. And the light was hitting in such a way that a rainbow bounced across the whole room. Now, I've been in that bathroom my whole life and that never happened. So I don't know what forms, you know, when we leave our physical bodies we take, but I do feel that if you're open to it, you can see certain reflections, you know, or I don't know, the television will start, the lights will start going off and on, or the television may shut off. I've seen that happen. And I'm curious about that. I can't claim to make it happen, but I'm aware of those, the feeling of another presence in an old space, or, you know, even when I enter a new studio or a space, I try to talk to the walls and just acknowledge whatever was there before me and burn some sweet grass or something to acknowledge that I'm not the first person here and that I'm coming in peace.
Do you feel it more acutely in your Sicily location than perhaps elsewhere?
Well, there's the ancient Mediterranean here. A lot of people tried to capture this land. It's been, from the Persians to French to Spanish. So you feel it in the rocks and the trees rather than in people. And definitely that volcano spitting out lava, or it's like some big angry female that is agitated and it'll either spit you out or take you in.
Yeah.
And Syracuse was as important for the Greeks as Athens. It was a New York City once upon a time. So you can imagine all these different boats coming in and the spices that they sell. You see these baskets of paprika and turmeric and different types of nuts. And you can smell the past.
Yeah. I think I want to make sure we see a couple of other things as our time is starting to sort of wind down. There's another video that we have where you are working with making those tiles that are incorporated into the tables. Do you mind if we watch that quickly? And Chloe, would you mind sharing it with us?
انا يميل عطفه الجميل حيث ما اتفق كم جرى هنا في الجداول موكب السنة كالجدائل كم جرى هنا في الجداول موكب السنة كالجدائل كل من رأى شعره الذهب تابع
That was made 2 days ago.
I'm glad. Was it really?
Yeah, because the lady that helps me was here, and it looks so easy when she glazes the tile, like making a crepe. But it's actually, you have 5 seconds, and everything has to dry evenly, and it takes about a year and a half of practice to make
again,
it look
it looks
like nothing.
It looks like it's being coated in milk. Once again, this idea of milk.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and the land of milk and honey here. It's also, I have to say, I really love my family and America, but it became so hard to live because the inflation of everything. I mean, they're incredible artisans here. My stretcher bar is to make a, let's say 10 by 20 foot painting. It's $300, where that would be, close to 3,000 if you had somebody make them in New York. So to be able to have space has just allowed me to find my own identity within all this space. In a different way than I was able to if I was driving to New Jersey within brick walls.
Yeah. So, I'm thinking of family. I'm thinking of this piece that you have talked about, sort of locating in Sicily in the place where you're now in, and it seems like maybe both have converged in Orange piece dismantled by cells before unity. And also perhaps this idea of the cellular is related to your experience with your illness. Do these things converge within this piece? It has that also that really vibrant orange that we were discussing earlier.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's say the X illness, because it's not around anymore.
Oh, yeah.
It's kind of a miracle. No, it's okay. But I don't consider myself sick anymore. This came out on February 22nd, which was the day that this war started in Ukraine. And then I feel that it's a little premonition for this Rowan Wade situation because, she's basically got a stillborn in her arms and there's this angry kind of priest screaming at her. and in the stomach part of the left side, there's this voice yelling, and then the bottom part of the female side on the right reminds me of when you go to the gynecologist and they put your feet in those stirrups. Mm-hmm. It kind of looks like a wishbone of a chicken bone, that shape. So I have to say that out of all the pieces in the show, this was kind of an angry moment.
Yeah, it definitely has an intensity to it that is of a different quality than some of the others. But I think it's an integral addition to the entire collection because it really illustrates the scope of what you were considering within your work from the ancient to the contemporary, and this kind of constancy or these evergreen themes of family and spirituality and struggle and justice.
This was the first one with relief too that sent me in the direction of making, I wanted to get out of mm-hmm. that square tile. It was driving me nuts that I had all these little squares to fill up, and I wanted to cut them into other forms.
Yeah.
Like I said before, the shapes told me what to paint. It's not that I had an idea before, I made these forms on it with clay, and then I saw the guy's face on the left and this woman that looked like she was holding a baby. So the piece kind of illustrated itself.
But
the timing of it with what was going on with the world was a little, prevalent to me.
Yeah. Well, the segmenting of the bodies too has this idea of violence, but also this notion of being a channel into which something else can flow, something that could potentially
influence change. You see that little seed in the middle, it's like a teardrop. And then on the right, there's a window. On the left bottom corner.
Yeah.
So there's hope.
Passageways. Yeah. Well, I think maybe it'd be a good time to transition to questions from the audience, but I don't want to jump the gun. And Lola, if there's anything that I have overlooked, please let me know.
No, you've been so gracious and generous with your thoughts. I'm really happy to meet you here. It's been an easy conversation.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thank you. So, Chloe, maybe?
Yeah, thank you so much, Patrick, and thank you, Lola. We do have a couple of questions from the audience. The first is from our friend GE. GE, I'm going to go ahead and unmute you so you can ask.
Thank you so very much, Chloe, and thank you, Patrick and Lola. Thank you. I've always seen, Lola, your work as kind of mediumistic. And could you tell us a bit about your making and how it's perhaps been influenced by Akashic Records and that sort of compendium of the universal events and words and thoughts? And is that an influence in the way you're making?
Sure. I had a show actually about 12 years ago called Akashic Records.
Oh.
And that was at Tripoli Gallery. And I guess we all have to face our own genealogy, right? I have Eastern European roots and am drawn towards kind of sad music and sad poetry, but I think that comes from that. And so I wanted to understand how much of my ancestors were living through me and how much of me was me, and that we come through two people, but we also come with our own voice, and what is nurture and nature. So I'm drawn to magic, even if it's false magic. You go to Naples and they've got these shops where they pretend to heal you and they put their hand on heat sensitive paper and then the fingerprints come up. Just the imagination or the effort to try to make someone believe that, I'm also interested in, and I can kind of smell what's right, what's not, where people are taking advantage of seekers. But there is a consciousness on the planet right now where I think people would like to heal one another and raise above what we claim to know. And maybe reincarnation will become something that's more of a fact in the next 20 years, because it's not our first time to the rodeo. And you can see that when you watch animal life or moths fly around a lamp, that you've kind of been that before. So I guess through my painting practice, I can access things that I don't get to see every day and paint those types of make-believe things, and then they become real.
So wonderful. Thank you so much.
Where are you, by the way? Are you in New York?
Upstate New York, in the Rochester area, on the unceded lands of the Wenhoven people. So, yeah. But I've lived all over in New York and Philadelphia and other places, too.
Are you a painter?
No, poet.
Okay. Well, I'll write your name down so I can look for your poetry. What's your name again?
G.E. Schwartz. Thank you.
Okay. No, thank you. I love your question.
Thank you, G.E. Okay. And thank you, Lola, for your answer. The next question is our last question, and it comes from our very own Fong Bui. And I'm going to ask on Fong's behalf. Given the nature of your working in various mediums, be it film, be it painting or sculpture, and now ceramics, all of which seem to share two things. The first thing, the fluidity of how the images emerge. And second thing, which is inseparable from the first, the fragility of the images themselves. How would you describe fragility as a condition of endless negotiation between strength and persistence?
What a question, Fong. Well, perhaps in our most vulnerable moments is when you can grow, right? In every doubt, there's a kind of truth. So it's important not to get hardened and bitter from all the things that we see. I don't know how we have to stay sweet with each other and be kind, but being able to be fragile and show yourself new to the world, I think that's important, to not have these different facades, especially in the time we're in. It's not the ego of the 80s, you know, to be the protagonist of your own film, you need to show that you've got human faults, because that's what people can relate to. So I hope that answers the question. I want to show you, Fong, I have your gift here. So the Brooklyn Rail made it all the way to Chicly.
Thank you so much for that answer. And thank you so much for this conversation about your show, which is on view for another week at Nino Meyer Gallery. So for our audience members that are in Los Angeles, we encourage you to go see the show. It's a rail tradition to end our NSEs with a poetry reading. And it's my pleasure to welcome our poet laureate of the day, Isa Guzman, to the stage. Poet, playwright, and Brooklyn College MFA graduate Isa Guzman is from Los Suris, Brooklyn. She dedicates her work to the hardship, traumas, and political struggle within the Boricua diaspora, especially the LGBTQ+, Boriquir, and trans communities within it. Isa helps lead several projects, including the Titere Poets Collective, La Esquina Open Mic, and La Cochina Workshop. She has published her work through several magazines, including the Poetry Project, Public Seminar, and others. Welcome, Isa.
Hi, everyone. Good afternoon. And thank you so much for having me, for being part of this wonderful discussion. I'm going to recite two pieces. The first piece will be part of an upcoming portfolio for our upcoming special folio at Apogee Magazine called Atlas Skin, Blood, Bone, Body Maps in Brown and Black. All the poets there will be talking about their disabilities. This poem is called The Moment I Tell My Mother of My Diagnosis. A mother's symptom, martyrdom. También debo tener eso, multiple sclerosis. Absolutamente. Those are her first words. Guilt, with an attempt at understanding. My spine shudders with scars and apprehension. I tell her, no, imposible. There were no symptoms and it would be in remission by now. She lived through 70 years of bonapens removed from her ovaries, the whole root de algo de la vida, pulled without a sign of daughters. She lived through 70 years in welfare lines, dressed in red lipstick. Y un grito que podía hacer al any family court just to raise me. 70 siglos of mistranslations and suspicions, a life hypervigilant, and dead mothers in her dreams. She tells me, ¿Qué es la remisión? ¿Cuál es la razón? ¿A dónde cogiste esto? ¿Qué hiciste? What did you do? Those are her next words for me. Blame. I've lived through 32 years of night terrors and disembodied limbs floating around the room. Fear as if my body would fail despite not knowing why. I've lived through smoke-infested fire escapes and roach-infested pancakes of fried chicken still bleeding from the bones. Shame for this body for un millón de reasons. My gender, my small kidney, my diminishing vision, my divergency, my exhaustion, my weakening leg, my numb hand. Qué clumsy yo soy. Rodrigo, that isn't how it works. And they don't know why. Y nunca sabían por qué. All I know is that every 6 months, I'll go in for treatment until I am 60. Si vivo a eso. My second piece is part of a mixed media art project I am doing. It's also an art poetry project. It is diving right into my experience with multiple sclerosis. This one is called Sclerotic Eye. It's part of a series, so this is the fifth one. A, embrace an evening of wanting the real, balmy sunsets on the nerves, a scattering of violets, yellow, bitter orange, reds, strokes of midnight blues, head heavy in rope raptures, the spinning is there and the left hand's plasticity, cars reaving through Fulton Street without saints or albatross to call upon. B, my lover is of urging water. I forget that we don't see the same. My nights rain with blindness and scotoma, with floaters and shadow play, with the incomplete sculpture of her face. She becomes a slab of obsidian I piece together from memory. I really want to see you right now. I'm drowning. C, our limbs plunge into shore break. We wrestle into sweat, into every molecule of salt, of the scoptic visions of green angels from our fevered bodies. A sign travels through my spine. I am burning filament, nerve on nerve in due collapse. I can feel the relapse grip me harder than my lover can. I could describe this disease as disappointment. Was diagnosis the injury? Could I have managed the unknowing vertigo, the euphoria of stillness that only came 3 a.m. when we were too tired to kiss? Could I have spent a life in cut up? Could you make me into a collage? E, a recurrence of check-ins. No, girl, I'm all right, I'll be fine. It'll pass in fraying sleep, in disseminata. Nah, really, I'm good, I swear. Just bury my brainstem in the last place I'll find it. Into the mantillas of lethargical blankness we found in Sappho, into the still eyes of oyster catchers at Fort Tilden, into the telegraphic speech of disassociative forgetting, or just some other day, a day I don't have to think about. Thank you so much.
Beautiful.
Incredible. Thank you so much, Isa. Those are amazing. That was really, really great. And thank you, Lola, and thank you, Patrick, once more for such an inspiring conversation. We'd also like to thank the Terra Foundation for sponsoring our NSE program and making these daily conversations possible. And for their support of our growing archive, you can view today's event and our full archive on the Rails YouTube channel. For 22 years, the Brooklyn Rail has brought together art, music, dance, film, theater, literature, and thoughtful social and political meditations in our monthly publication and in our public events, like here on our daily NSE. Please check the chat for a link to donate to support our writers, editors, and operations here at the Rail. And as is tradition in the NSE, you can now turn on your microphone and say goodbye as you leave. Thanks again for joining us today.
Thank you for organizing this. It was beautiful, good combination.
Thank you so much. Thank you, Patrick.
Thank you for the conversation. Thank you, Isa, for that reading. Thank you, Lola. Thank you, Patrick.
Yeah, thank you, Isa.
Thank you.
Incredible. Yeah, thank you so much.
Thanks, everyone.
Thank you, Lola.
That was amazing.
Thank you so much.
Thanks, everyone, and have a lovely Friday.
Have a blessed weekend.
Love you, Lola.
Thank you.
Love you too, Nat.